How many of you born in citizens? Talk about the right. So there was a famine in India in 1966, and U.S. Congress had passed a law called PL-480 to ship wheat to India on the rupee payments, because India didn't have dollars to pay with. And so image of India was, really third world country which had not even feed itself. And so when we arrived in 67, that was the image we had to put up with. And this professor, he talked about the very first meetup is there. He brought me into his office and said, "But you're from India, you'll have trouble here, because your education is probably not up to snuff." He was very, pretty blunt about it. He says, "I don't want you to fall behind. I don't want you to fall behind, because that'll be terrible. So I want to make sure that you get extra help." And here I am from IIT Bombay, and he told me that if you need any help, stop by my office, and if you need help after hours, telephone me. Then he picks up a telephone and says, "This is your telephone. This is how you use it." So that was our image, right? And a month into that class, he had a shotgun quiz. And so I aced it very quickly. So he asked me in his office, he says, "I want to remind you that we don't cheat in America." And because nobody was supposed to ace that quiz. And the second quiz, he gave a month later, he stood right behind me for a whole hour. And they said, "If you're cheating, you're very good at it." So the image of Indians did start to change in early 70s. A large number of Indians were coming. And at universities, it became very clear that Indians are pretty good in math. They were doing fundamentals. And by mid-70s, that image at universities was fairly well established. So that problem was gone. But same problem happened in the industry, in 70s and 80s. But I think most of those things are behind us. So that wasn't the point I was going to make. But most of us had to put up with that one in 60s and 70s, because that was a very pervasive image, everywhere. The Indians were, India was third world, the British had to sort of rule them because they couldn't rule themselves. That was the wisdom here. And they can't feed themselves. We have to ship this almost free food from here to keep them alive. And by late 70s, the image was very smart tattoos. They're very smart tattoos. Their stuff works, their software works, their designs work. But that was a single dimensional image. They're very smart tattoos. Can they sell? Can they manage? Can they market? None of those other things were established. So when we started to become entrepreneur, I arrived in the valley here in 71. I came to US in 67, but I arrived in the valley in 71. And late 70s, I was here almost 9-10 years in the valley, and there were friends who were doing the startups. So maybe I'll tell you a story, how this startup happened. So there was this person who worked for me, as a technician. He was a British, English guy, and his name was Michael Jackson. Not Michael Jackson. what was his name? David Jackson. David Jackson was the founder of a company called Altos Computers. I don't know if any of you remember Altos. Altos was one of the original hotbots company, around the same time Apple was announced. It was based on Z80, and it was a CPM machine, and it was very, very popular. David Jackson used to be a test engineer in my lab, and he worked for me for 2 years, and he left to start Altos. And here I was doing extremely well as a system engineer at a company here in Sunnyvale. And as all of a sudden it hit me like a ton of bricks, that David Jackson, somebody I trained, who had come as a fresh immigrant from England, And 2-3 years later, he's an entrepreneur. And here I'm doing, I have a job. I've been at job for 9-10 years by that time. And I just don't sleep that night. He said, what's the matter with me? Is he an entrepreneur? He was smart, but he wasn't as sharp as I am. And that was my self-image, right? And I started to really have trouble explaining to myself, why should I not be an entrepreneur? And the problem was I was doing extremely well financially. I was making $75,000 a year. And in 1980, $75,000 a year at that time is making about $300,000 a year, right now. Maybe even more. But it was very high end of income bracket. I was a very high thought of engineer. And so I told my wife, I'm married here, my wife is US. I told her, I want to quit my job and I want to become an entrepreneur. And she says, what's the matter with you? we have such a nice house, we have two kids. Did I do something wrong? why are you not put us all through hardship? We are making you're doing extremely well. Everybody respects you, and we have everything we need. And I said, but David Jackson is an entrepreneur, and I am not. after a few days, few weeks, she got tired of arguing with me. She said, do whatever you need to do, but make sure that the kids don't suffer. I had a son who was 1 year old, and my daughter was 3 years old at the time. And I said, I and two other friends, there was a person by the name of Naveen Jain, he's still in the valley, and Indra Mohan said, Indra was from IIT Kharagpur, I was from IIT Bombay, and Naveen was from BITS Pilani. And Naveen was a PhD in software from CMU, and Indra and I were hardware guys. But Indra was from Dunstru. He had done Dunstru. He was a very polished speaker. So Indra became our CEO because he had to face outside. I became VP of engineering. And this is now at the dawn of the IBM PC. PC has just been announced in 1981. And it was up in the air that the world is about to change. The mainframes and mini computers were going to become history. But this is right at the front edge of that one. And what should we do? And after 2-3 weeks of thinking through, I said, maybe we should do the networking. We should network all these new machines that which are emerging. The Altos was there. The computer based on Motorola 68000. And there was national chip at the time, national 16,000. Around Unix were being built. They were called hot boxes. Super mini computer, mini super computer. What were they called? Super micro computers. Super micros. They were being built, and they were starting to replace the mini computers. And so people were buying PCs. People were buying the super micros. They had these mini computers. They had those mainframes. And I said, why don't we network them all together? And Intel, Xerox, and Digital, had announced Spectral Ethernet. There was a blue book published by them in 1981, around the same time PC was announced. And they said, they will, this spec should be used to build a network. And Ethernet was a new type of network, CSMA CD, which was first time a bus-based network, which was, it was CSMA should be tangent sense, multiple axis, collision detect, technology. And both Intel and Digital announced that they will have chips ready in about 3 to 4 years, for this specification. And I looked at the specification and I said, I can't design a board right now. And I started to pencil, on the paper here a design, and I was able to design using about 30 chips. And I said, I can't find anything wrong. So there were three of us. He said, why don't we build a few of these boards and see if they work? So we pulled our money, $10,000 each, and we built about 4 boards. And designed the Ethernet board for a PC, for a multi-bus, the same design with the different buses on it. And it worked right away. I said,